Good morning and a hearty rainy day. Now we are going to have a topic on the last part of the kidney, that is KFT, kidney function test, the different kidney disorders, and the last one, that is the dialysis or the artificial kidney. And lastly, we go to renal transplantation. So this is the slide which shows the kidneys. They are the vital organs and the different parts of the nephron. Now, kidney, as we have seen, they have the regular function of most important, that is electrolyte and fluid balance, then the acid-base balance, and the elimination of the different metabolic waste products like urea due to protein metabolism, uric acid, creatinine for the muscle metabolism, and the other waste products are also excreted by kidney. It also has important role in blood pressure regulation, endocrine functions because vitamin D3 activation, 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol activation, erythropoietin formation. It forms part of the RAA system, red blood cell production, and prostaglandin synthesis. So most importantly, there are so many disorders which are there in everyday clinical practice. Usually we do the blood investigations, and then we have been told about the urine analysis. So in day-to-day practice, urine analysis plays a big role for identification of the diseases. So why do we do the renal function test, that is RFT, to identify the renal dysfunction? Maybe due to any reason, pre-renal, renal, or some other causes related to it. It may be metabolic or any clinical other features. To diagnose exactly the renal disease, we can have the renal function test. To monitor the disease progression, because in some hypertensive nephropathies or glomerulonephritis, nephrotic syndromes, in these conditions, the disease progresses, the renal function test changes. So we can have diagnostic criteria, and we can do the kidney function test. To monitor the response to treatment, we are giving a lot of treatment to the patients, and we have to see that the treatments are going on properly. Is the disease progressing? Do we want to change the drugs? So this is very, very important for it. And changes in the function that may impair the therapeutic efficiency of certain drugs like digoxin and certain chemotherapeutic agents. Now, this is a typical urine analysis. We have the different dip tests which are available. A colored things are there, liquid biopsy of the urinary tract. It's a painless procedure, it's non-invasive and not so expensive. There are still other techniques also available. You can have these dip techniques are also there. And much information we get very quickly. So we can get a diagnostic, a prognostic, other features of it. The three stages of analysis. First, we just look at it. That is the gross appearance, the volume, the color, or anything which is appearing in the urine, the odor. Then we can see the cells, cast, crystals, and certain bacteria. We can do the bacterial investigation, the microbiological investigations. And then you can do the pH, the osmolality, that is the biochemistry. So here we require the department of biochemistry, the department of microbiology. And lastly, even radiology is required. And we can also do the kidney function test with the help of the pathology department. So this is how, this is the fresh samples, and we can do the urine analysis and the other kidney function test in different manner. These are the different arrays of colors of the urine samples, and different reagents are mixed and you get the different functional test of urine. So in gross appearance, first of all, we go to the amount. The amount that is the amount of urine about 1000 to 1800 ml per day. There are three conditions if the amount is less or it is more. So polyuria 2.5 liters per day. In some nephrosclerosis, in diabetes, in pregnancy. Pregnancy, it is physiological. Then you have oliguria and anuria. Oliguria is less than about 400 ml per minute per day. And anuria is about 100 ml per day. Polycythemia is frequent but small amount because of some tumor or infection. The color changes. It is normally yellowish in color. The color is due to the different bile pigments which are present and uroerythrin which is also present in urine. And certain food and drugs causes the changes in the color. If blood is present, it is hematuria, reddish colored urine, and you have certain myoglobin which gives some blackish red colors. So we have an array of colors. By seeing the color also, you can get some diagnosis. Then next is in transparency. In infections, you may have turbidity in the urine, blood, redness, some bacteria may cause certain changes in the transparency, fungi, odor, typical urine odor you have, and sweet odor, you have the acetone type of odor, and you have ammoniacal odor. So color pigment is urochrome, it is yellowish in color due to the hemoglobin breakdown pigments, bile or bile pigments. Beets or rhubarb, vegetables, they can change the color of urine. It might give a urine pink or smoky color. The vitamins, we can take multivitamins, they give a yellowish color to the urine. And then infection, you have a cloudy type of urine. Odor. So odor is usually ammonia because ammonia gives a typical smell. In diabetes, you have fruity odor. In inborn errors of metabolism also, the odor of the urine has a typical, it is typical. In diabetes insipidus, the odor is like asparagus. It's also like vegetable. So different biochemical tests which we do in a laboratory, like the pH, by the pH meter or the pH sticks are available. We do the glucose stick, urine sticks are available. You can do glucose on the machines or also you can do it by the urine sticks. Protein analysis, then microalbuminuria or albumin analysis. RBCs, if they are present or not, hemoglobin pigments, hemoglobin, in case of jaundice, increase in bilirubin in urine, you can diagnose by it. WBCs, present pus in urine, that is the WBCs, they are larger in size, rounded WBCs are present in cases of urinary infections, strictures, stones, then nitrates, then bilirubin present, the urobilinogen if it is present in excess of amount, then ketone bodies, then specific gravity can be done and osmolality can be done. So pH is normally 4.8 to 8. Then in cases of metabolic and renal acidosis, the acidity in urine can increase. It's higher in alkalosis near 8 and lower in acidosis and higher in alkalosis. Diabetes and starvation, the pH will decrease. There is acidosis. Urinary infections also the pH may increase because of alkalosis. Certain bacteria, they break down the urea and you give the alkaline-like reaction. Protease and pseudomonas, they are urea splitters, they increase the pH. It depends on the infection also, you can change the urine pH. Specific gravity from 1.0, it is given in some books as 1.001 to 1.040. So this is a range. High specific gravity can cause precipitation of solutes and formation of kidney stones. When the tubules are damaged, the urine specific gravity approaches that of glomerular filtrate 1.010, which remains fixed, where about 2/3 of the nephron, they have been lost. In diabetes insipidus, where the ADH problem is there, or the tubules are not responding to ADH, we have a dilute urine and the specific gravity decreases, 1.003. In diabetes mellitus, it is 1.030. In fever, MSS, it becomes 1.040. So in concentrating and diluting ability of the kidney, the specific gravity and the osmolality of the urine can change. The different urine sediments you can see in the diagram, you can see different type of sediments. You have seen the calcium oxalate crystals, which are there in the acidic urine. Then uric acid crystals, leucine spheres, sodium urate crystals, tyrosine needles, cystine crystals, amorphous urates, and in alkaline urine you have amorphous phosphates, calcium carbonate crystals, ammonium urate crystals, calcium phosphate crystals, and triple phosphate crystals. You have different casts in the urine, hyaline casts. They are from the proteins of protein surfaces. These casts are derived from the proteins which are coming out from the tubules or the glomerulus of the surface proteins. They give the hyaline cast. They are called as a hyaline cast, and usually they are rounded in shape. And then you have the granular cast. On the hyaline cast, you can see a cylindrical cast that is blue color. That is the hyaline cast. If on the hyaline cast, if the granular, it gives a granular appearance because of RBCs, WBCs, and even due to some other bacteria, they give the granular cast. Then we have the waxy cast. Then renal tubular cells also can be sometimes seen. The mucus threads can be seen. Also, you have the spermatozoa. If after intercourse or some spermatozoa can be there in females, bacteria, yeast, very common yeast is present in the females, and WBC cast, convoluted hyaline cast. So different type of casts are there, which also gives up. So microscopic analysis should be followed by biochemical tests. If they are positive, then you should do the microscopic examination. And then if you suspect bacterial or some other infections and want to do the testing, then you can do the culture of these urine, which takes about 24 to 48 hours for the culture. And culture specificity, drug cultures can also be done. Looking for the count, the cellular and inorganic elements in the sediments. And 4 hours later, you can do the sampling and you can do the microscopic examination. Hematuria is a condition in which RBCs, it may be normally during menstruation along with the menstrual flow. When there is catheterization, cystitis or bladder stones, inflamed prostate, benign hypertrophy, or certain cancerous conditions, you have hematuria. And still many more. There are so many conditions where there will be hematuria. Cast, they are precipitated from cell lining the renal tubule, red cell in tubular bleeding, white cell cast in tubular inflammation, and epithelial cells can be seen in degenerative sclerosis of the glomerulus. Crystals in infections, inflammations, and stones. White cells in pyuria, urinary tract infections, and bacterial infections. Substances which are not present in urine but may be present in certain disorders. So you have acetone, bile, bilirubin, glucose, protein, albumin. Albuminuria usually is not present. Renal disease involving the glomerulus. Then next is blood urea nitrogen. Urea produced by breakdown of amino acid, which is influenced by diet, dehydration, and hemolysis. Normal range is 10 to 20. If the GFR decreases due to renal disease or due to any blockage, ischemia of the kidney, then BUN will increase. It's a screening test for abnormal renal functions. Then you have the clearance studies. There are different clearance studies. One clearance study, which is for the glomerulus. There are two types, that is inulin clearance test and urea clearance test. This is for the GFR. Then you have certain clearance tests for the tubules. And for the tubules, we have creatine clearance. It's an end product of muscle metabolism. Normal is 0.7 to 1.5 milligram deciliter in the plasma. It can be compared to creatinine in urine over 24 hours to determine the clearance. It's an indirect measure of GFR in renal blood flow. Amount excreted is equal to amount filtered. It is neither reabsorbed nor secreted. It is useful to monitor the changes in chronic renal function which increase with trauma and massive muscle. Even with exercise, the creatinine clearance can change. If heavy exercise, also there are some changes. So, is it physiological or it is pathological, we can do the creatinine clearance test. The diagnostic testing, that is inulin clearance and pH clearance, which is for GFR. Now, we go to the different conditions, which are, this is the renal problems, which are there. Now, before going into this renal problems, I would just want to do the other diagnostic procedures which are done for the kidney function. One is micropuncture techniques, Stoff flow techniques for tubular functions, microcryographic techniques, and microelectrodes, where the membrane potential of the cells, like tubular cells, DCTs, collecting duct can be done and the changes can be noted. And then you have miscellaneous tests like the IVP, that is pyelography, intravenous pyelography. In this pyelography, certain dye like diode rest or Ilopax is used. 15 grams per 20 ml of glucose is injected in about 2 to 10 minutes. You can see the dye in the urinary tract. This, then you can do the serial radiographic examination. Different serial x-rays are taken, and then you can see any strictures, stones, crystals, and any disturbances in the kidney or in the urinary tract. Even the ureters and all can be seen properly. Then you can do certain other tests like the alkaline reserve. The blood pressure has to be taken of the patient, then the pH of the blood, then arteriography of the female femoral artery. In femoral artery, you can inject the dye, and then you can see the artery and its branches. If there is any sclerosis, if there's any strictures in the arteries, or in any occlusions can be seen by this arteriography. Then next, the most important, usually done off and on, every patients which have problems with the renal function, you go to USG. It's a very good diagnostic procedure. You can get all so much information from the ultrasound, and you can do echo of the blood vessels also. So we have any problem with the blood flow in the renal arteries also can be done. USG, you can see the bladder, you can know about the kidneys, regarding any stones, strictures, even prostate problems we can come to know from the USG. Then PET scans and MRIs and all are still there, still investigations are there. We can even go for further investigation if there is any cancerous conditions. And then lastly, we can do the biopsy. So biopsy, fine needle aspiration cytology in suspected cancerous conditions or due to hydronephrosis, certain kidney diseases, we can do this type of investigations. So there are still many investigations, an array of investigations which can be done along with the other urine investigations. Then we go to the disorders. So in most common disorder which is there, which comes to the OPD every day for the medicine people, even the surgical people, that is urinary tract infection. The patient will present with the signs of burning micturition, itching, pain during micturition, or he cannot, oliguria, he cannot pass urine, maybe due to so many causes. So urine, and maybe it may be due to some blockage, or most important, very common condition, that is UTI, which is very, there may be even fever with it, associated with it. There may be hematuria. So presenting signs and symptoms will be so many. So you have to rule out, you can do the urine examination. So UTI is a common disease. If the bladder, it may be cystitis or pyelonephritis or nephritis. If urethra is infected, it is called as urethritis. It's common in women because they have a short urinary system, short urethra. So due to that common infection, and sexually active females, it is very, very common. Even in small children, infection chances are very more, fungal infections, vaginal moniliasis, and so many other type of yeast infections, they are very common. UTI symptoms include painful urination, burning sensation, pain in the groin, pain near the pubic symphysis, then frequent urination, incomplete urination, then bloody or brown urine. This can lead to chills, fever, nausea, vomiting, even upper abdominal tenderness, and the renal angle, and even the pain and the renal angle. So presentations can be very different. If left untreated, so again the investigations are done, you even require sometimes sonography, intravenous pyelographies can be required sometimes. All UTIs can, sometimes if you don't treat these patients, then there will be damage to the kidney, damage and possible leads can lead to renal failure. So it is very important to treat this patient and to a faster extent. The general treatment, the most important, you have to for the antibiotics. Norflox, ciprofloxacin, these are the common. You have to do the culture of the organisms and accordingly you can give the antibiotics. A culture of the urine, even sometimes blood culture is also required. If there are atypical organism, which type of organism, reaction to the antibodies, antibiotics, accordingly you have to give the treatment. And a personal hygiene, you have to advise the patient to drink lot of water, and also a person should maintain a proper hygiene and drink lot of water and have a proper diet, which will improve the urinary tract infections. Then nowadays, very important, kidney stones. It's also a common kidney disorder. There are different in acidic urine and alkaline urine. You can see the different type of stones we have seen in the picture. Oxalate stone, urate stones, and these are due to precipitation of the normal substances which are present in the urine, like the calcium stones, stagon calculi. So these stones can be lodged in the kidney, in the tubules, in the major calyces, minor calyces. The size also will vary, the type of the stone can vary. So you can do the urine analysis, and after that you can go for the x-rays, intravenous pyelographies can be done. And also urine cultures can be done. Sometimes these stones are the niders for bacteria. So recurrent urinary tract infections, also the stones can lead to recurrent urinary tract infections also. Hydronephrosis, these are the conditions which stones will lead to. Backward pressure in the kidneys, the calyces and all will swell. Kidney swelling will be there. Painful, it's a very painful condition, the stone. Sometimes the stone may pass off, or sometimes you require lithotripsy, ultrasound guided lithotripsy procedures, or even surgical removal of the stones is required. So it depends on where it is, how it is, and you can give certain drugs which are there which can dissolve the stones. Certain hydration therapies can be given. So there are so many treatments for the stones. The most common is the calcium oxalate, which others would be uric acid cystine stones. They are common in men, women. It is more common in men. Recurrent urinary tract infection, insufficient water intake, desert conditions, low levels of physical activity, obesity, too much vitamin C and D intake. One of the best ways to decrease occurrence is to drink a lot of water and to change your dietary habits. Symptoms like severe pain in the back, abdomen, blood in urine, nausea, vomiting. So symptoms can be varied. A big stone but no symptom, it depends on where it is lodged. Even a very minor stone, just some millimeter, if it is having a very great blockage, it will totally lead to anuria. So there may be oliguria, anuria, and it will be very painful. So in this condition, sometimes you have to just break open the bladder and remove and catheterize the bladder directly and remove the residual urine. It is really painful in certain conditions. So diagnosis, medical examination, x-rays and ultrasonography. Treatment will vary from simple medical treatment, that is drugs can be given, or then you have to give ultrasound shock lithotripsy, or sometimes it can pass on its own. So there are so many modes of treatment. Large stone will require surgical removal. And the most common thing which is going on nowadays is the renal failure. So many diseases which are there, hereditary diseases or the glomerulonephritis, nephrotic syndromes and hypertension. So you can lead to a damage to the kidney. About 70 to 80% if the kidneys are damaged, then only the typical features can be there. Sometimes the kidney has a great power to restore itself, to do its normal function up to great extent. Even up to 20 to 25% of the kidney tissue is remaining. The rest is sclerosed. Still the water electrolyte balance, the other functions are carried out by the remaining nephrons. So they have a very great adaptive properties. So due to this adaptation can last long, but then up to certain extent, if more than 20, only less than 20% of the kidney tissue is remaining, then you have to go for the other things, that is dialysis is required, or even we have to go for kidney transplantation. There are different conditions which are there. One is the acute renal failure. It's a sudden development within hours or days, and GFR drops suddenly. It is very rapid decrease in GFR. There will be oliguria and even severe anuria. In most of the cases, it is reversible sometimes. It is. But in some cases, it may become irreversible and it can progress ultimately to kidney failure. So it depends on the conditions which has precipitated. Second is chronic renal failure. Develops for months or years, slowly because of hypertension, sclerosis, glomerulonephritis, immunological syndromes, or due to so many conditions, it can lead to chronic renal failure. We have a list of conditions which leads to chronic diabetes is one of them, and still other. We have a list of conditions which leads to chronic renal failure. It's an irreversible condition. It will progress. There will be mild, moderate, and severe. It will take certain weeks, months and even years to develop. So chronic renal failure, it is also one entity. And then end stage renal disease. The chronic renal failure can ultimately lead to a condition end stage renal disease, that is ESRD. This is how in maximum time we call this as ESRD because of chronic renal failure or some other disease that is end stage renal disease. Acute renal failure is sudden loss of kidney function, period of hours or days, rapid decrease of GFR, retention of, there is uremia, leads to a progressive uremia and progressive increase in creatinine, BUN, which is azotemia, associated with classical findings of oliguria, fluid, electrolyte imbalance, acidosis, and usually reversible with prompt treatment. The classification according to the location of the insult, it is divided into pre-renal, renal and post-renal. In pre-renal, the blood decreases blood flow to kidneys because of some conditions that leads to about 50 to 70% ischemic damage to the kidney, sclerosis in the blood vessels, even hypertension can lead to pre-renal condition of acute renal failure. Then intrarenal causes, some conditions in the tubules, damage to the interstitium of the kidney, damage to the glomerulus, the ureters, it can damage intrarenal conditions, which will actually occur damage to the kidneys in about 20 to 30%. And then you have the postrenal obstruction of the urinary excretion due to stones, strictures, damage to the system, which occurs in about 1 to 10% of it. Pre-renal conditions, decreased renal perfusion, the blood flow is decreased, there is ischemic damage to the kidney, GFR, oliguria, due to decreased GFR, there is oliguria. Most common cause is hypotension, hemorrhage, severe and abrupt. Then there is hypovolemia, increase in breakdown of RBCs, which can block the kidney tubules, low cardiac output states, treatment to correct the cause. If not corrected, it may lead to intense intrarenal failure and acute tubular necrosis. Intrarenal, you can see it is due to acute tubular necrosis. Damage to the renal tubules caused by ischemia, drugs, toxins, radiations, and characterized by degree of cellular damage or death of the tissues. Ischemia, and one is nephrotoxins due to IV drugs, contrast dyes, heavy metals, antibiotics, and also the most common culprit, NSAIDs, that is taking drugs for pain. We can do testing pre-renal versus renal acute renal failure, urea and creatinine in serum, pre-renal urea and creatinine increase, in renal both they increase but not so much. Protein in the urine is absent in pre-renal condition, it is present in renal condition because it has damaged the tubules, the hyaline cast increases, the granular cast increases, there may be albuminurias and protein in urine. Then urine, pre-renal, renal, less than 20 sodium, here will be more than 40. Plasma osmolality in pre-renal, it is more than 1.5 to 1. And in renal, it is less than 1.1 is to 1. Urea less than 10 and plasma urea will be more than 10 and less than 5. So post-renal conditions that block the urine flow distilled to the kidneys, it is caused by obstruction below the kidneys in the urinary tract, calculi, tumors or masses, blood clots, benign prostatic hypertrophy. Decreased urine output, that is oliguria, anuria, oliguria less than about 50 ml, anuria also there will be there, and causes urine to back up into the kidneys, eventually decreases the pressure, increases the pressure leading to decrease in the GFR. So that leads to nephrosclerosis. It's a vicious cycle, and ultimately, like if there is any changes in the kidney tubules, that will lead to changes. There will be hypertension that will cause natriuresis and to bring the kidney functions to normal. There will be pressure natriuresis and pressure diuresis, and ultimately, this will in long run, we don't know exact cause of it, that will ultimately lead to nephrosclerosis and still more damage to the tubule. So initially they will try to maintain the electrolyte and fluid balance, but after in long run, due to some unknown causes, there will be nephrosclerosis, damage to the kidney tubules, ultimately progressing to end stage renal disease, and ultimately in these conditions the renal function have been hampered, and what is required now ultimately is the dialysis, that is the artificial kidney, which we go in detail later on. Then you have is chronic renal failure. It's a progressive, irreversible loss of renal function over a period of months to years. So about, as I have already told, 80% tissues will be damaged, still the kidney can function, have its normal function, because it's a reserve. It has a basic reserve and it can manage its function, the water balance, the electrolyte balance and the hormonal balance. But the nephrons are destroyed and replaced with scar tissue, that is nephrosclerosis. The remaining nephrons, they will become hypertrophy and they will take over the function of the diseased nephron, resulting in systemic disease that is called as uremic syndrome of CRF. The etiology of renal failure, a lot, vascular diseases, most important, diabetes mellitus, very, very common. In this age of even the corona, which is causing problem to these diabetic patients, the people diabetic, they go on artificial kidney, that is dialysis in long run. Even the hypertensive nephropathy, it has increased like anything. About 151 per million patients in India are suffering from this end-stage renal disorders. And we require so much of dialysis, about 55,000 patients going for dialysis. And then ultimately, if it is more damaging to the kidney, the last resort is kidney transplant. Even that is not easy because it's a costly procedure and you require the donors, and the matching is required, immunosuppressive therapy has to be taken. So in long run, the end stage renal diseases are causing problems, and the most common cause is diabetes mellitus, 35%, hypertension, glomerulonephritis. There are so many types of glomerulonephritis, nephrotic syndrome, vascular diseases, infections, Fanconi syndrome, nephrotic medications, nephrotoxic medication, NSAIDs, drugs taken for pain, painkillers, they are causing a lot of problem to the kidney. So kidney patients, then toxic agent exposure, sickle cell anemia patients, those who are taking blood transfusion, this blood transfusion products, they block the kidney tubules, there is bilirubin, biliverdin, crystallization, systemic lupus erythematosus, pyelonephritis, obstructions, polycystic kidney disease. This is also very common. The first transplant was done on a patient of polycystic kidney disease because the patient had end-stage renal disease. There are three stages: reduced renal reserve, stage 1, about 40 to 75% loss of nephron function. Usually it is asymptomatic, the normal BUN and creatinine. Stage 2, it progresses, 75 to 90% loss. The BUN creatinine increases, kidney lose ability to concentrate urine. There will be, the specific gravity will be unchanged if you increase water intake or decrease water intake. So the concentrating and diluting ability of the kidney will suffer. There will be polyuria, nocturia, and even anemia, because erythropoietin formation by the kidney will be less. Even the vitamin D deficiency because of 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol formation and all will decrease. Stage 3 is end-stage renal disease, ESRD, which is a main problem for the kidney patients. It's a final stage with more than 90% loss, characterized by steep increase in the waste products, electrolyte imbalance, sodium, potassium, problems are there, there will be acidosis, uremic symptoms, and requires lifelong dialysis. If the patient passes into an ESRD stage, then dialysis is the only cure for it. And then still we can do is the kidney transplantation. But there is a long list of patients who are lined for kidney transplantation. Kidneys are not easily available. You can get the kidneys from the cadavers. You can have certain in 2011, a law was passed where the brain dead patients, we can fill the form, we can tell them for organ donation. And after that, we have got a lot of kidneys, heart transplantation, liver transplantations. So that can be done. And also, we can have dialysis. There are about 750 dialysis centers across India, and they are still increasing. And you have transplantation centers, which are very less. And still, we can have the kidney transplant. If the dialysis is if the kidney is still failing, then ultimately, you have to go for dialysis. Even living tissue, in 90% of patients, we have the living individual giving kidneys, and in 10%, you take it from the cadavers. There is the nephrotic syndrome, increased glomerular capillary permeability. Because in nephrotic syndrome, we can see there is some damage to the nephrons and the basement membrane of the glomerulus. Ultimately, because of loss of negativity, there will be albuminuria, increased albumin in urine. The albumin-globulin ratio, which is there in the blood, will be reversed. And you have heavy proteinuria. Lot of protein will be lost in the urine. There will be hypoalbuminemia, loss of antithrombin C, and hypogammaglobulinemia, which will lead the patient susceptibility to infections. If loss of albumin, the osmotic pressure will change. That will lead to edema because of water loss will be less. Compensatory increase in lipoprotein synthase leads to hyperlipidemia, increased cholesterol, and hypercoagulable state because of loss of antithrombin C. So biochemical complications will be anemia because of problems of decreased erythropoietin production. Lifespan of RBC decreases, nutritional deficiencies, fatigue, shortness of breath, and even angina. Renal osteodystrophy, a syndrome of skeletal muscle changes found in chronic renal failure from alterations in calcium and phosphate metabolism, elevated parathyroid level. The parathyroid reabsorbs calcium and phosphorus from bones, and which attempt to increase the serum calcium. Long-term effects is bone deformities. Increased triglyceride levels, increased blood sugar, diabetes-like manifestation, then bleeding tendencies, risk of infection is increased, and reproductive dysfunction of infertility and decreased libido. So now for this group of patients of ESRD, we go to the thing that is known as dialysis. So what is actually dialysis? It's done on patients with acute or chronic renal failure. And the basic principle is to pass blood through minute blood channels which are bounded by a thin membrane. And the process of diffusion is used, or ultrafiltration process is being used for in the dialysis machine. So when two fluids, one is blood and the other is a dialyzing fluid, they are two separated by a semi-permeable membrane. So these crystalloids and colloids can pass from one from higher concentration to lower concentration. So we can change the composition of the dialyzing fluid according to the patient's need. And by this machine, it can act like the kidney for removal of waste products and additions of the required ions, or even what substances which are required by the body can be added through this membrane. So this is a dialyzing. It's on the membrane, on the other side of the membrane, this is a dialyzing fluid into which unwanted substances in the blood will pass by diffusion. So the history of the kidney disease, and when we go to history, the first dialysis was done in 1943 by a Dutch scientist. He gave us about dialysis, that is, and in 1933, it was first done it is called as dissolution. In 1943, William John Kolff, he gave us regarding dialysis, and first dialysis was done in 1913 in animals at the John Hopkins Institute. So, So the basic, it is done on patients with acute or chronic renal failure. There are two types, hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, and still more. This is the basic principle. So see this, in this you can see the hand where a atriovenous anastomosis is done, or you can have a atriovenous fistula development. So there is cephalic vein and brachial artery, which is used for forming of the atriovenous fistula. Then from the artery, the blood is taken out and it is taken through the tubes through the dialyzer. This is called as the dialyzer. You can see the dialyzer. You would require some heparin pump because anticoagulant has to be added. At one instant of time, about 500 ml of blood passes is present in the dialyzing unit. That is called as a dialyzer. You can see the membrane. It's a semi-permeable membrane. It's made of cellophane or cellulose. And in one side you have blood and the other side you have a dialysis fluid. Now how much you can use a pump to increase the flow. You can increase the size of the membrane. The pore of the membranes can change. The pressure can alter the dialysis. The amount of time the blood remains in the dialyzer also can alter the amount of substances which can be exchanged. So all this leads to, what are the substances which are present in the dialysis fluid and what are the present in the blood? On blood, if it's a uremic blood, so we don't have uric acid, urea, creatinine in the dialyzing fluid. It passes from blood to the dialysis fluid. Sodium, potassium, chloride, magnesium, phosphate, they are present in the dialyzing fluid so that these substances do not pass from the blood to the dialyzing fluid. Even glucose is present. But in conditions, you can change the composition of this dialyzer fluid. What you can do according to the need of the patient. You can change the composition of the dialyzing fluid so that the waste products can be removed efficiently. You can increase the pressure, you can increase the size of the membrane, you can increase the time which is for the blood to pass. So anything we can do, a pump will be there, and also you have an air trap is there. When it comes out the blood, there is an air trap. So if an air is mixed into the blood, it can cause deleterious effect on the body. So air trap is also the toxic. So now you can see all the toxic substances passing in the dialyzer fluid. This dialyzer fluid can be then removed and you can add a new one. So when you can see that this the dialyzing fluid is highly saturated with the waste products, you can remove it and put a new fluid. And toxic diffuse through the membrane. So this is called as hemodialysis. We can do the peritoneal dialysis. In peritoneal dialysis, the peritoneum is used as a dialyzer machine. And the dialyzing fluid is put in the peritoneal cavity. And when the blood passes through this peritoneal cavity, there will be exchange of the base products in this the peritoneum through the peritoneum into the peritoneal cavity. You can remove the fluid after the saturation is complete. So this is also one. You can do it at home also. So home dialysis can be done and it can be done by the patient. You don't require a nurse or anything. So this also can be. And lastly, we go into is the transplantation. The first kidney transplant was done in the 1901. By Flexner, he tried to say that we can do transplantation of tissues. In 1933, it was done in USSR, but it was failure. Then Ruth had taken Dr. Richard Lowell in 1950, the first successful one, but the patient just lasted for 2 to 3 days. Then next, the first most important was done by Boston in 1954 by Dr. Murray, and he receives a Nobel Prize in 1990 for his renal transplantation. So then lastly, that is the renal transplantation. There are many laws and all for renal transplantation, so we can't go in detail of it. So that is what regarding my topic of kidney and its disorders. Thank you.